Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Gildan Audio presents an unabridged recording of Moxie, The Secret to Bold and Gutsy Leadership by John Baldoni. Narrated by Timothy Andres Pabon. Prologue. Give me a place to stand and a lever long enough, and I will move the world. Archimedes. Moxie. The very word conjures up images of tough-talking guys with bent noses and fedoras pulled down low over their eyes. It is a word that was common in the 1930s and typically associated with people born on the wrong side of the tracks. Common people to whom circumstances hadn't been kind. They had to make do with what they had, even if it meant using their fists. Prizefighters were said to have moxie, an inner sense of toughness. They knew how to fight as well as how to take a punch. They were tough guys, and the hard knocks they had endured showed on their faces. 75 years later, moxie is not a commonly used word, but it's one that is a favorite of mine. I like to apply it to leaders who have an inner sense of toughness. Most don't come from a hard scrabble or mean streets background, but all have endured a number of fights. Not in the ring, nor in places they had to use their fists, but they were punchers all the same. They're guys and gals who had what it takes to lead others in tough circumstances. Moxie is the essence of what makes a leader tough on the inside and soft on the outside. These people know what it means to get knocked down, but better still, they know how to get back up. They also stick up for others, especially when the chips are down and you want them on your side. And lucky for you, they most often are. By definition, moxie is gumption, get up and go, guts, courage, and determination, otherwise known as perseverance, all rolled into one. These are traits any leader needs, but to me there's another aspect. Moxie was the name of a soda pop, a carbonated soft drink. And so, without stretching too much, you can put a little sugar on the concept, because tough leaders have appeal. A little honey that draws people to them. They are likable. Why moxie? After the financial crash of 2008, we often heard senior executives declare that they'd never seen things so bad. Trust in management plummeted. A survey of senior leaders conducted by Booz Allen in early 2009 showed that 46% of those surveyed doubted their CEOs had a credible plan to deal with the crisis, and 50% doubted that their company had the leadership necessary to execute such a plan. This lack of confidence didn't come from rank-and-file employees, but rather from the senior-most leaders of organizations. That's pretty damning. As with most crises, it passed, but its wake left devastation in terms of loss of wealth, jobs, and frankly, confidence in leaders. Slowly but surely, wealth and jobs have been restored, not as much as we've hoped, but the trends are positive. Except for those regarding leadership. According to the National Leadership Index for 2012, compiled by the Center for Leadership at Harvard Kennedy School, 69% of Americans surveyed viewed leadership in crisis mode. Not unexpectedly, faith in government and corporate officials has eroded over time. But there is hope, because when respondents were asked how America could solve its problems, 81% said, effective leadership. Leadership post-crash isn't really any different from leadership pre-crash, except for one thing, resilience. Those who have steered their companies back to prosperity did it by making tougher, wiser choices and moving forward in hard times. In short, these leaders have moxie. Flash forward to the present. In my coaching, I have the privilege of working with men and women at every level in organizations, but as my practice has evolved, I've begun to focus on those at the top of their game, those who are leading their organizations. They have guts, gumption, and they know how to get glory for their teams, their companies, and yes, themselves. These folks have moxie, and it's something that every leader would do well to put into practice. I define it as one part courage, one part can-do spirit, and one part recognition. In this book I call Moxie, I explore how the concept focuses on what leaders need to be as well as what they need to do. In short, Moxie is an acronym. It stands for mindfulness, leading to opportunity, leading to the X factor, and then innovation, and then to engagement, which all feeds back into mindfulness. Specifically, leaders need to be mindful of their circumstances, as well as of their strengths and shortcomings. Leaders must be opportunistic in the sense that they want to make positive things happen. They also need to have the disposition to succeed, as well as the inner resourcefulness to persevere. Leaders know that risk is involved with most ventures, so they must be willing to do things differently. They must be innovators. And all good leaders know that they by themselves accomplish very little. They must engage with others in order to achieve sustainable goals for themselves, their teams, and their organizations. Moxie is an attribute that successful leaders use to make a positive difference in the world in which they live. Leaders with moxie have four key attributes. Fire. Leaders with moxie burn with a desire to make something happen. They have a passion for what they do, whether it's building a business or running a small nonprofit. They have a need to make a positive difference in the lives of others. Drive. Leaders with moxie have ambition. They want to get ahead, and for that reason, they'll make short-term sacrifices for long-term gains. Their ambition isn't all personal. They want others to share in their own good fortune. Resilience. Leaders with moxie know how to pick themselves up after a fall. They've known defeat, and it doesn't scare them. It only provides the motivation to get back up and try again, not necessarily the same way. Street smarts. Leaders with moxie know how the world works. They know how to read people, those who are with them, as well as those who may be against them. They have a good sense of what makes people tick, and for that reason, they're pretty savvy when it comes to making deals. Speaking realistically, leaders with moxie are those who have the competence to do their jobs, they're often called go-to people, credibility to bring people together, people trust them to do the right job at the right time with the right resources, confidence to believe in themselves as well as in the strengths of others. In short, people feel better being around them. Put these characteristics together, and you have a person who knows himself and what it takes to get ahead. A leader with moxie wants to be in charge. He loves the responsibility that comes with setting the course for others to follow. He is accountable. A leader with moxie is dependable. She can be counted on to do the right thing and to bring others together for a common purpose. She's a straight shooter, and for that reason, people like being around her. We can also look at moxie as a means of dealing with the world at large. Consider moxie as an acronym. Mindfulness. People with moxie know that good things happen to people who seek them. Such folks are aware of their situation, and most importantly, are aware of their ability to affect positive change. Definition. A mindful leader knows the situation as well as his capabilities and those of the people around him. Opportunity. Individuals with moxie don't wait for things to come to them. They look for new opportunities. They are seekers of the new and different. Definition. An opportunistic leader looks for ways to make things better. She is motivated by a desire to make a positive difference. X factor. Each of us has a unique set of talents and skills that we use to make our way in the world. More than talent, it's what makes you, your character, convictions, and personal beliefs. Consider this set the X factor, what enables you to do what you do and do it well. Definition: a leader with the X factor has what we call the right stuff of leadership. She radiates character and uses her ambition to focus on the right goals. She has the persevering spirit that radiates resolve. Leaders with the X factor are humble, and their humility attracts others to them. Innovation. Individuals who have Moxie aren't content with the status quo. They continually seek to acquire new skills and apply them in new ways. Definition: an innovative leader knows that life isn't lived in a linear fashion. Sometimes you need to take risks. That means thinking differently, doing differently, and rewarding others who do the same. Engagement. People with Moxie seek to engage with the wider community. They are focused on making a positive difference in their teams and in their organizations. Definition: an engaged leader knows that he can achieve little by himself. These leaders engage the talents, but more importantly, the enthusiasm and spirit of others in order to achieve results that enrich, reward, and perpetuate the organization. Throughout this book, you'll read interviews with CEOs and thought leaders whose experience in leadership positions gives them the authority to illustrate the attributes of Moxie based on their own experience. These interviews, coupled with the stories of the men and women profiled at the head of every chapter, present a portrait of Moxie that reveals character, courage, determination, and resilience that are instructive as well as inspiring. My approach in Moxie is to show rather than tell. That is, I want the leaders whom I have selected to present their ideas and insights in ways that will engage your mind, stimulate your innovative spirit, and provide a foundation for continued leadership growth. Those leaders who put Moxie into practice are those who prepare themselves for the constancy of change and set an example for others to follow. Moxie then becomes a principle by which individuals can put their leadership selves into gear in order to accomplish a goal for themselves, their teams, and their organizations. In Moxie, we'll see how individuals with Moxie at their core succeed. Leaders with Moxie are those to whom others look for guidance as well as inspiration. Moxie lives. Moxie equals guts plus gumption plus determination divided by goals. Mindfulness. From the quiet reflection will come even more effective action. Peter Drucker. Wisdom of Perhaps. Donald Altman, psychotherapist and author of books on mindfulness, likes to tell a story that he calls the Wisdom of Perhaps. The tale has been told and retold in many different forms, but here's a quick synopsis. A man comes home early from work, and his neighbor asks him why. The man replies that he's just lost his job. The neighbor says, "That's the worst thing that could happen to you." The man replies, "Perhaps." A day or so later, the man encounters an old friend in the banking industry. When the friend learns that the man is out of work, he offers him a job as a senior executive right on the spot. The man accepts, and the next day arrives at work so early that the moving crew is still there. The man lends a hand, and as luck would have it, wrenches his back and goes home. When the neighbor hears what happens, he says, "You're the unluckiest guy in the world," to which the man replies, "Perhaps." The next day the bank is robbed and employees are held hostage, and of course the neighbor has a response. "Boy, are you lucky you hurt your back." "Perhaps," the man replies. Events occur often outside our control. What we can control is our response to those events. As Altman explains, one little event doesn't define us. One adversity doesn't define us. Often when we reflect on our lives, according to Altman, adversity actually has a silver lining, so we can take the attitude of perhaps with us on a daily basis. Mindfulness gives individuals the perspective to take a step back and reflect on the situation. Things can be bad, of course, but it falls to the leader to seek to make things better. Mindfulness. People with Moxie know that good things happen to those who seek them. Such folks are aware of their situation, and most importantly, are aware of their ability to affect positive change. Nelson Mandela. Nelson Mandela liked tea. Certainly he enjoyed the briskness of an afternoon cup. Or perhaps he liked the fact that it was a habit of the English, one he had learned while studying law at Oxford as a young man. Whatever his reasons, Mandela used the ritual of afternoon tea as an extension of his warm and open personality, particularly when greeting guests. Tea, which he always insisted that he pour, also became a symbol of control. When after nearly decades of captivity it became apparent that he would eventually be released, the South African government decided that it must learn to deal with Mandela as a political force that might one day rule the country. For that reason, the prison authorities gave him his own house on the grounds of a mainland prison, and when government officials came calling, Mandela played host. Even though he was a prisoner, he was the master of his house. He was its lord as well as the designated tea pourer. In this way, Mandela slowly, and not coyly, asserted himself as one who must be reckoned with. World leaders come and go, but few have captured the imagination like Nelson Mandela. Born into royalty in his homeland, he assumed chiefly duties. Seeking wider influence, he soon ran smack into the vicious and oppressive apartheid system designed to keep black Africans, the overwhelming majority, in a state of subjugation. As head of the African National Congress, Mandela was tried on terrorism charges and sentenced to 5 years in prison in 1961. He was sent to Robben Island, a remote spit of rock in the Indian Ocean, 4 miles off the coast of Cape Town. Later, when his papers were found in a distant farmhouse, Mandela, still in prison, was tried on treason charges and sentenced to death. His death sentence was later commuted, but the hardships endured. He pounded rocks in the blazing sun, day after day, years upon end. It was mindfulness, as well as the cohesion of his comrades on Robben Island, that enabled him and his fellow prisoners to persevere. While such treatment may have broken a lesser man, it only fueled Mandela's conviction. On the plus side, he was surrounded by his brothers in arms, fellow members of the ANC. In time, he was hailed as the hero of the liberation movement in South Africa, which gained momentum during the years of his incarceration. During this time, Mandela looked forward, and in doing so, learned Afrikaans, the language of his jailers, as well as Afrikaner culture. He came to understand that unlike the English, who might re-emigrate to Britain or another Commonwealth nation like Canada or Australia should black people come to government, the Afrikaners, descendants of Dutch farmers who had emigrated to southern Africa in the 17th century, were home. They referred to themselves as Africa's white tribe, and they weren't going anywhere. After Mandela was released to worldwide acclaim and adulation in 1993, he traveled the world. When it was decided that there would be free and fair elections, he ran for president and won. This thrilled the hearts of his fellow Africans, but absolutely terrified the whites. Mandela, being a wise man with a capacity for human understanding that dwarfed most others, understood that he needed to pull the nation together. His method was rugby. South Africa, long banned from international sports competition, was designated the host nation for the Rugby World Cup of 1995. This was a huge deal for the Afrikaner population, less so for fellow Africans. But Mandela understood that this was his opportunity to make a statement to Afrikaners that he needed them as partners in the government as well as partners in the nation. As told in the book Playing the Enemy, and later depicted in the movie Invictus, Mandela ensured that Afrikaner tradition in rugby would be upheld. The Springbok emblem, a symbol of oppression to Africans, was allowed to remain as the symbol of the team. The team itself was all white, save for one player of mixed race background. Mandela took personal interest in the team, in particular its captain, François Pienaar, and in doing so he helped infuse the team with a sense of playing for their country, white and black. The Springboks were underdogs, but with a sense of destiny, pulled off the upset of the era, ensuring that if only for a moment, there was one South Africa. Only someone with Mandela's sense of purpose could have shepherded a nation whose government was so virulently racist through a peaceful transition that facilitated reconciliation and allowed the country to survive. Myth surrounds Mandela, and on the one hand, it's glorious and fitting. Few men have ever endured such oppression and emerged so unscathed, at least in a moral sense. He was kind, compassionate, and generous, but he was also steeled for his duty. He suffered losses in his family, and eventually in his marriages, but he remained true to his cause. Mandela exemplifies what it means to be mindful, aware of your situation, but at the same time focused on what you can do to improve it. Many people saw the need for change in South Africa, but only a few activists were willing to take the risks involved to fight this uphill battle. Luckily, for most of us, the stakes are not so high. Still, we can all learn from Mandela's example, and it holds relevance for us today. One of the things I like to do when I begin a coaching engagement is ask my new client this question. What gets you up in the morning? If I see a smile come to the person's eyes, I know that I've tapped into something powerful, what he enjoys doing. The answers are as varied as the executives. Some get excited by tackling new challenges. Others enjoy problem solving. Others the thrill of competition. And many like working with their teams to achieve intended results. The answers to this question open the door to greater understanding. When an executive says he likes to see what his team is accomplishing, I know that I'm working with an individual who is placing an emphasis on the right thing, working with the team. On the other hand, if the individual says she likes working on projects and contributing in that way, I realize that she's more suited to being an individual contributor. The most troubling answer, or more precisely, non-answer, comes from the individual who shows little interest in the work. His answer may be a symptom of burnout, or it may be an indication that he doesn't find the work challenging. In either case, this person is going through the motions. It happens to the best of us. Situations at work may change, so what we once liked to do is no longer possible, or we lack the motivation to continue much longer. My advice is to find something else about the job that you love, or perhaps look to things you like to do outside of work. Tap into your passion. When the low point comes, and most worthwhile endeavors have a moment when the obstacles look large, you'll need that passion to push you through it. Self-awareness. Knowing what gets you enthused comes down to self-awareness. The capacity to know oneself is essential to being a leader. Self-awareness is the ability to understand yourself as well as to know how others perceive you. Too often we overlook self-awareness as an important attribute of strong leadership. According to a 2012 survey of 17,000 employees conducted by the Hay Group, only 19% of executives possessed a degree of self-awareness. As Ruth Malloy, a vice president with Hay Group, put it in an interview, if you think about most people in our day-to-day lives, we tend to run on autopilot. We often are not mindful about our impact on others or how and when we spend our time. We can easily get caught up in the task or the day-to-day distractions. As a result, we lose touch with ourselves. How we build our self-awareness says something about how we'll succeed as leaders. The first step is acknowledging that we have work to do. Often that comes from feedback we receive from a trusted source, be it a boss or a colleague. Applying that feedback so we make positive changes is essential. Malloy told me, "Developing self-awareness requires reflection." This echoes advice I've heard from other executives, that you, as a leader, must build reflection time into your schedule. It could be alone time. It could be time shared with colleagues. The point is to find an opportunity to get perspective on your situation and think about what you need to do next. Or, as Malloy said, to think about how you could react differently in the future. It's not unusual, for example, for a leader to have a number of employees who like the old way the company did things and who find her passion frightening. If you're not aware of what others think of you or the situation, then it can be difficult to connect with them. Leadership requires persuasion, and that can only occur if the parties understand each other. We develop self-awareness when we take time to learn from others as well as to listen to what others tell us. Self-aware leaders know what's happening around them. They live in the present, but are aware of the future. They know that what they do has consequences, and for that reason, they are attentive to how they interact with others. The fact that so many executives are lacking in self-awareness resonates with my work in coaching. I like to say that executives are so busy focusing on others that they often overlook themselves, specifically the effect their actions may have on others. This isn't always bad. An executive who's setting the right example in terms of his communications may not be aware of how well he's connecting with others. By contrast, a manager who is deficient in his ability to delegate work may not realize how much of a micromanager he's become. Self-awareness is fueled by mindfulness, the ability to think and act in the present. Mindfulness is a state of being, and it requires attentiveness to the here and now, as well as to what's happening with others. Self-knowledge. Savvy leaders develop self-knowledge through mindful practice. It can begin with patience. For the many leaders whose internal motor powers them to act, the concept of patience can seem foreign. It can be perceived as passivity. In actuality, patience is an active process. While we cannot control the situation, we can control how we react to it. Mindfulness, as described by psychotherapist and best-selling author Donald Altman, enables us, quote, to find a state of equanimity. As Altman says, the brain is Velcro for negativity, and so we can be tilted emotionally in a way that doesn't allow us to be effective. Mindfulness enables us to check our emotions so we can discern things with a clear perspective. As such, mindfulness enables us to listen, engage, and connect with others in a more open and honest way.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.